song.
Fabulous. Right. Thanks, Tarkan. Okay, now on with the show. We've got our next speaker, who used to be at a small company called General Electric, and then he went to another small company called Wipro, and now he's gone to a really small company because he's with a startup. And so we wanted Vivek Paul to come up here and give his 15-minute TED-like talk. Vivek?
Yeah, Mark. Thanks. Great to be here. So I was listening to Tarkan and, really high-energy presentation, learned a lot. So what I thought is I'm going to share a few stories with you, I guess. So just relax, and I'll share a few thoughts. So first of all, I was on the plane coming from San Francisco to Bangalore for this conference. And as frequently happens in the run from California to Bangalore, you run into many IT services folks on the plane. So I said hello to a couple, and one of them tells me, so I asked him, I said, what are you doing nowadays? So he goes, well, I have started this little company that I work on in the evenings. And so he said, every morning I go to work to die, and every evening I go to this company to live. And I thought, that really is what probably defines the people here. Because there's absolutely no reason why anybody should go anywhere to die. And if any of you feel that way, as strongly as he did, and you're here and you're not sure about whether you're an entrepreneur or not, you are an entrepreneur. There's that right inside you. Get with the program. So, what I've done a lot as I've met various people in, different walks of life is ask them, can you share with me the story of your life? Because I've always found some really amazing stories. And so when MR asked me to do the same for this session, I thought it was only fitting. So what I'm going to do is share with you this amazing story that I heard from an individual and goes back a long time in history, but really was a pretty amazing story. And it influenced me a lot. And I hope that some of the lessons will be helpful to you. But really, the concept of entrepreneurship in my mind got started there. So I used to run this company called Wipro GE Medical Systems. When I was at GE, we set up a joint venture with Wipro. And so while I was running that, I was in Chennai to meet with this hospital that I was hoping would buy our medical scanners. And so I was told that there's this patriarch in that hospital who makes every decision. He decides not only what's going to be bought, but where the equipment will be housed, where that building will be built, etc. So I went to go see this gentleman. He must have been in his late 70s, early 80s at that time. And as I mentioned to you, I asked him, so tell me the story of your life. And what he told me was the most amazing story, at least for me. So he says, when I was a teenager, it was my father passed away. And my younger brother was much, much younger than I. And I pretty much had the mantle of managing whatever we needed to in the family. And he said, we had a small farm. And so he said that I started growing vegetables. And then I learned that, you could export vegetables. And so I started exporting vegetables. And then he goes, I learned that when you want to export vegetables, your vegetables rot because they sit at Madras port outside in the sun, and as you can imagine, they rot. And he said that I found out that the British, and at this time the British ruled India, he goes, Britishers could get sheds where they could put their vegetables. So he said, I asked them, can I get a shed as an Indian? And they said, sorry, only Britishers. So he said, what I did was I went to the chairman of the Madras Port Trust house. I knew where he lived. And every morning I would show up there at 6:30. And at 7:30, this guy would go for a walk, and I would follow him at a respectful distance. And he said, I did that for 4 months. And then finally, this guy turns around and says, all right, what do you want? So he said, I told him, I'd like a shed, because I'd like to export some vegetables, and I'd like a shed. So this guy goes, well, I really admire your get up and go. I really admire kind of, your chutzpah. And so he said, what, I'll give you a shed. But more than that, we're actually thinking of bringing an Indian onto the Madras Port Trust trustee board. Would you like to become a trustee? So he said, I told him, I said, I don't know how to read or write. And the Britisher goes, don't worry. When I go into a board meeting, when I open my folio, you open your folio. When I close my folio, you close your folio. That's all you got to do. So this guy, illiterate, becomes the first Indian trustee of the Madras Port Trust. So anyway, so the story goes on, and he does quite well, vegetable business does well, and then he says, you know, then my brother and I started having some tension, as happens in family businesses. And he said, you know, my wife's uncle had died, he didn't have any children, and he left her a small printing press. So I told my brother, you keep the vegetable business, I'll go run this printing press. So he said, I started running this printing press, and he was, you know, like every printing press, you know, you make these flyers and stuff like that. And I thought, you know, I got to do something more than that. And so he said, what I did was, I thought, let me start a magazine. And he said, I realized that there was no children's magazine, and I launched Chanda Mama. And, you know, most people here are too young to know what Chanda Mama was, but it was an amazing story. He launched the country's biggest children's magazine out of the small printing press in Chennai. And he goes, then I went on to go into the movies, and he goes, I made movies like, again, probably dated for many of you, Ram or Shyam, Sita or Gita. And so he became one of the largest motion picture producers in India and became the president of the Indian Motion Picture Association. And now here he was trying to decide where he was going to put this MR scanner in the hospital, and I was just in a state of shock and awe. I mean, I was thinking to myself, here's somebody who has demonstrated that entrepreneurship is not about any particular age. It's not that there's a right age to be an entrepreneur or not, that you can be an entrepreneur in whichever way you want. What he was showing to me was that there is actually a freedom that you have with every avatar that you create as an entrepreneur, where you completely shed the past and you go into the new future with the basic set of skills that you have, which is, in his case, as you can tell, you know, really hard work and the ability to really focus on the details. And so I have to say that from my perspective, what I learned from him was that, you know, you should have absolutely no hesitation to go from one business to another, learn different things, and be able to carry all of the learning you have, but yet none of the baggage from business to business. So that moved me, and I, you know, as MR said, I've done a few things in my life. And so I thought that what I'd do is share maybe a couple of other episodes and things that have happened that might be interesting. So one of the jobs that I had was I ran GE's global CT scanner business. And when I was appointed to run that business, it was about a $1 billion business. I was pretty young. I think I was about 34, 35 at that time. And it was a pretty flat market, you know, like most Western sort of global markets, it was pretty flat. GE had about 20% market share. And at that time, the CT business for GE Medical Systems represented 122% of the profitability of GE Medical Systems. In other words, the rest of the product businesses lost money. CT was the one that made the money. So I come into this business, and I'm sort of trying to figure out where we go from here. And you know, I realize that we actually have the makings of a major new product platform. So we have a lot of things in place here that could drive us to the sort of completely new era. So we put together a lot of our thinking, and we actually developed this whole new product plan. And as we looked at that, what I realized was that this was a pretty dangerous product plan because it was a big bet. So anyway, so I figured that the best way to do this, to figure out whether this was worth doing or not, was to actually gather all of the other business unit line managers within GE and their engineering managers. We got in a room, everybody sort of looked at my plan, and they all fired bullets at it. They were all like, you know, you gotta focus on this, you gotta focus on this, you gotta focus on this, you gotta focus on this. We copiously took notes. And then at the end, I asked all the business unit managers, I said, tell me, if you were in my shoes, would you go ahead with this plan? And the answer unanimously was no. Mm-hmm. I said, okay. So the next 2 weeks, we analyzed every single objection that they had given. And what we realized was we had a way around it. We could tackle it. And so I went to the guy who ran GE Medical Systems, now chairman of GE, and I mentioned to him, you know, we want to go ahead and do this. So, you know, what do you think? You know, if you want, I can share with you the pluses and minuses. And, you know, this is only can happen at GE because it's your business, you decide. So I'm like, okay. So we did it. We went for it. You know, we actually were a great success. It basically took GE from 20% share to 70% share, competing against all the large majors like Siemens, Philips, Hitachi, Shimadzu, Toshiba, blah, 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 blah. But for me, the reason why I thought this was an interesting event for you and something that I have tried to replicate in future sort of experiences in my life is that you have to seek everybody's counsel. You must listen to everybody, but at the same time, you must listen to yourself first. You've got to keep your own counsel. Listen to everybody, but keep your own counsel. And I heard that somebody in the world, I was very fortunate to find something that really excited me, not just as an investment, but as an entrepreneurial venture. I looked at the space of enterprise social media, and what I saw was not just a business opportunity, but a fundamental way of organization that was different, in as big a way as when the first military model was used by organizations. And as I looked at that model, I said, this will change the world. I don't know if I can or if Kinetic Glue can, but I know that this will change the world. And I am really excited to be part of that journey. I'm really excited to be part of the entrepreneurial journey that I know many of you are already embarked on. And I hope you wish me well, and I wish you all the very best in dreaming big and living big. Thank you.
Thank you, Vivek.
Thank you.
Here's a token of appreciation.
Thanks.
Oh, hang on.
Yeah. Sorry.
Thank you. Okay, our last speaker for the morning.